Sarah Phillips. I'm the director of the Russian and East European Institute here at IU. And we are just very delighted to welcome Professor Kurilla to deliver the second of two talks that he has agreed to share with us at IU this week. Professor Kurilla has a doctorate of science in history, and he is a professor of political science and sociology at the European University of St. Petersburg. Previously, he was professor and chair of the Department of International Relations and Area Studies at Volgograd State University, the city from which he originally hails. He has also been a visiting scholar here in the U.S. In the U.S. at George Washington University's Elliott School of International Affairs, and also at Dartmouth College. I'd like to point out that Professor Kurilla is our inaugural speaker in a new lecture series that we at REEI have launched over the next 4 years called the AMERICANISTS. And it is an effort in this time of complicated U.S.-Russia relations to really tap into and take, pay attention to and learn from our colleagues in Russia who are specialists in American studies. So this will be rolling out over the next 4 years, and we're just really gratified that Professor Kurilla has agreed to be our kickoff speaker for the AMERICANISTS series. The series is a partnership with the Department of History, the Departments of American Studies, and African American and African Diaspora Studies here at IU. And part of the goal with the AMERICANISTS series is also to highlight histories of people of color and negotiations of diversity in the former Soviet Union and across Eastern Europe. So I'd like to say just a few words about Ivan Kurilla's expertise and his publications. He is a specialist, of course, in American studies and also U.S.-Russia relations. He has several publications that have come out in the last few years, one of which is called Frenemies, History of Opinions, Fantasies, Contacts, Mutual Misunderstanding of Russia and the USA. That's with NLO Press in Russia. It came out in 2018. That is a Russian language publication. In English, you might be interested in an edited volume that he has published with Victoria Juravlova, and that is Russian/Soviet Studies in the United States, Americanistica in Russia, Mutual Representations in Academic Projects, and that was in 2016 with Lexington Books. Going through all of his accomplishments and publications on U.S.-Russia relations and historical perspective would take many hours, so I'm not going to do that, but I did want to mention two very interesting current projects that Professor Kurilla is working on. One is a book manuscript under preliminary contract with Cambridge University Press, together with David Fogelsong and Victoria Juravlova. That's called History of U.S.-Russian Relations. And he has another book project in the initial stage, at least according to his CV online, called Russia and the United States During the Civil War Era. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome all of you to the talk, which is called Frenemies, U.S.-Russian Relations from a Historical Perspective. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah, and thank you, Indiana University, for inviting me here. It's a big honor for me to be starting inaugural lecture here this in this series, and I wish this series will be successful, and I'm sure it will be very interesting. Okay, I'm going to speak today about the Russian-American relations, and I will speak, by the end of the lecture, we'll come to the contemporary situation, but I will try to start with the earlier stages, and we'll try to find in the history of our relations some explanations to the models and patterns that are still relevant and are still influencing the bilateral disagreements, cooperation, whatever you'll find in the long history of our contacts and encounters. But I will start just briefly with explanation of of my methodological approach. It will be very brief, but to understand what I'm going to say later, I'll need to speak a little bit about constructivism. Probably many of you know what constructivism is, but just, you know, to be very very short. There is an important question for any social group, including the nation. The question is what we are, who we are. And to answer this question, there is usually two main ways to answer the question. One is to explain what you are internally. I mean, if you are a nation and you're trying to answer the question, this type of question, you will speak about your history. You know, we are those people who raised against British metropolis back in the 18th century, or we are the nation that won a victory over Nazism during the Second World War, or whatever. Or we are the nation which are united by some ideals we believe, and we share the ideals of freedom, liberty, and so on. And there is also the other way to answer this question, who we are, with what we are, is to compare yourself with somebody else, usually with a neighbor. And if you have some big, dangerous neighbor, you always compare yourself with that neighbor. You know, if you travel to Canada, if any Canadian here in the room, I ask Canadians what does it mean to be Canadian, and the most popular answer was, we are not Americans. So this is something, you know, to explain yourself, you need to say where is the border between you and your neighbors, and you are somebody who is not your neighbor. Well, many of Russian neighbors answer similar way. I mean, many Ukrainians will say that answering the question, what does it mean to be Ukrainian, will answer that they are not Russians, or Belarusians will answer this way. But if we speak about the United States themselves, or Americans themselves, or if you speak about Russians, it's not as easy to find the way to whom you will compare yourself. Because, well, Americans probably do not answer this question that Americans are not Canadians or not Mexicans. It will sound strange. And Russians will not answer the question that they are not Ukrainians. It also will start to sound strange. And there are also some big, significant other with a capital O, which you used to, we Russians, you Americans used to compare yourselves, or ourselves. For many years, for many decades, or maybe centuries, even until the early 19th century at least, or maybe late 19th century, the major other to compare ourselves, both for Russians and for Americans, was Europe. For Americans, probably the most important other was England, or France to some extent, or Europe as a whole. And Americans, during the time of Thomas Jefferson or George Washington, or even early 19th century, would compare themselves with Europe and say that the differences that Americans are building this republic based on the liberty and popular representations, while Europe is monarchic, lagging behind, culturally backward society. And that's how Americans describe themselves, by describing Europe as a lagging behind. And for Russia, Europe also was a matter of comparison. At least since Peter the Great, since the early 18th century, Russians did compare themselves with Europe, and Europe was a model. To a large extent, and Russians wanted to be like Europe in many ways, including development of modern society, modern economy, modern military, and that was an important concern. And what happened during the development of this this comparison? Gradually, Americans started to single out Russia as an embodiment on everything in Europe that Americans did not like. Russia was the most eastern part of Europe, or some will say that it's already beyond the Europe, but okay, looking from America in the 19th century, Russia was still Europe, but the most lagging behind part of Europe. So Russia was the most autocratic of all European countries. That's something that Americans did single out in European experience. Russia was the most you know, the least free, the least free in among the Europeans. So by the end of the 19th century already, Russia was started to be used by American politicians, American journalists, as an embodiment of everything un-American. You know, that you will, if you read newspapers, even back in the 19th century and so all the 20th century, American newspapers, and look, just look up for Russian as a in the title of some local newspaper somewhere, you will frequently find these titles like Russian politics in Chicago. And that means that Chicago mayor, you know, behaved himself as an autocrat. And so it's not about Russia, but Russia was an embodiment of autocracy, autocratic way of rule. You know, politicians continue to use Russia as a synonymous for un-American, for everything Americans did not like in Europe as a whole. By the way, there is sometimes people ask, and even now people in Russia and in America would ask, why Americans compare themselves with Russia or not with, say, China. Okay, even now, in the nowadays, China is much less democratic than even Russia under Putin. And Russia, China is still communist, and China is much less free than Russia, even in the contemporary situation. And why Americans prefer to compare themselves with Russia? Okay, back in the 19th century, when all of this discursive approach did form, China was beyond what at that time was considered a civilized society, and American politicians just could not explain Chinese politics in the language they can describe themselves. But Russia was within this like bigger European civilizational area. So Russia could be described using the same language as that was used to describe American political system. But within that language, Russia was on the opposite pole. And China was just beyond that pole. China was exotic. China was something you cannot explain by political language of the 19th century when it all started. So as a result, as one of the results of this, China was mostly brought, Chinese knowledge about China was brought to America by people who studied culture, philosophers, culture specialists. And you know, China was portrayed as a country with, you know, 5,000 years of philosophy, of, you know, ancient culture, and nothing was said about politics. So Russia was described mostly by politicians, by those who criticized and used political system of Russia as a comparison to American politics, as something that they wanted to use to make a comparison and to highlight achievements of American civilization. So this is just for start for a methodological approach, and let's go back to history, and I will now try to say how two countries, two societies, how Russians did see Americans and how Americans did see Russia during this a little bit more than two centuries of our relations. The first image of America in Russia was an image of a country of Indians, of Native Americans. And yes, you know, back in the 18th century, the first knowledge, the first news from the United States were news about these tribes of Native Americans. And what was interesting, that those news began to appear in Russian media approximately at the same time when Enlightenment, French Enlightenment writings was also published in Russia. And if you remember Jean-Jacques Rousseau idea about the noble savage, you know, that's one of the ideas of Jean-Jacques Rousseau was that civilization is something that spoils human nature, and those people who are not parts of the civilization, who live somewhere in the wilderness, are the most noble and simple people. the ideal people to some extent. And so the Russians read the stories about Native Americans as a description of this noble savage from the, you know, Enlightenment point of view. And that was very different compared to how Americans themselves, or white Americans, perceived Indians in the 18th and 19th centuries. And this is an interesting tradition. If you look through the tradition of Russian depicting of Native Americans, you will see that, well, until now, and especially in the middle of the 20th century, Russian depiction of Native Americans was much more positive than American depiction of them, because it was, you know, it was started in Enlightenment. If you compare, you know, that was Western movies in the middle of the 20th century, the very popular genre of Hollywood movies, and those of you who did see all of these Hollywood classics know that that usual depiction that those Indians were depicted as a threat, as somebody who can, you know, who attacks and cowardly attacks, you know, pale-faced Americans. I as a child, watched different type of Western movies, made, produced actually by GDR, by German Democratic Republic studio, and that was a Western movies, a series of Western movies. Usually the main character was a Yugoslav actor, Vojko Mitic. And it was, you know, that was movies which resembled American classics in any aspect. It looks like pure Hollywood Western movie with one major difference. Native Americans in that movies were on the right side, and white people were cowardly, you know, cowards, and those who tried to cheat in Native Americans and to kill them. So that was a reverse attitude to all of that. So the first image of America was a country of Native Americans. By the way, the first usage of very word American was applied to Native Americans. You know, the distant relative of Leo Tolstoy, the elder, his, you know, sixth cousin or sixth uncle, Fyodor Tolstoy, in the early 19th century, got a nickname American. Fyodor Tolstoy in America. Fyodor Tolstoy Americanists in Russian. Why? He participated in the first Russian circumglobal navigation with Krusenstern, with Russian captain, and he was so bad behaved during the ill behaving in the expedition that Krusenstern at some point left him alone on some Pacific island with a supply, with food or something, but, you know, he just did not tolerate him anymore in the expedition. Fyodor Tolstoy got his way back to Russia. Probably a year later he appeared in Petersburg with all of his body covered with tattoo. He got a tattoo probably somewhere in the Pacific Island. And we do not know if he ever entered American shore, but he immediately got nicknamed an American. American meaning this wild person from there. You know, that was a story in the early 19th century Russian high society meetings when, as a part of the cultural program, when the women were sent to the different room, he put his shirt off and showed his tattoos. Probably the first tattooed person in Russia. So he got his nickname American. The second image of, and you know, all of these images still exist, but they added one to another in some historical circumstances. The second image of America was a very important one, and it was during the American War for Independence, and that was America as a country of freedom and country of liberty and a country of the model political system. And that was very important. Since that time, immediately during that American Revolution, and in any every generation of Russian after that, revolutionaries or reformists in Russia used the United States as a model of a better political system. In, you know, Radishchev, the first, probably the the first Russian revolutionary, or first Russian political critic of autocracy in the late 18th century, during Catherine the Great period, published an ode to freedom, to liberty, вольность, which was actually addressed to America, to American country, which was, you know, portrayed him as a model. And he was, after that, he published another book, The Trail from Moscow to from Petersburg to Moscow, very critical to the Russian serfdom, Russian political system. And he was exiled to Siberia. And there is a memoirs of some Catherine the Great AD about the discussion about Radishchev he had with Catherine the Great. And Catherine the Great said that Radishchev is a rebel much worse than Pugachev was. Pugachev was the head of the huge peasant rebellion in the 1770s. He was worse than that rebel because he praises Franklin and he wants to become like Franklin for Russia. He himself wants to become Franklin for Russia. And that was an interesting turn of the point. And that since that time, most of the Russian revolutionaries used the United States as a model and wanted to portray the future of Russia as something resembling the United States, and for the top authorities, for the monarchs, tsars, and the general secretaries in the 20th century, it was a threat. Decembrists, you know, the biggest Nobel uprising against autocracy in Russia took place in 1825, and those people in December of 1825, that's why we call them Decembrist rebellion. Those Decembrists prepared the constitution for Russia, the drafts of the constitution for Russia. And they used as a model of those drafts American constitution, constitution of the United States, constitution of Massachusetts, and they used American, America as a pattern, as a model. One of the Russian scholar, Alexander Etkin, even called his article, made the title for his article about Decembrists, the rebellion of Americanists, instead of Decembrists. And that was a next generation. So it went on, in the 20th century, those who criticized the Soviet power, many of them, not all of them, but many of them also used the American example or America as a model they wanted to reproduce in Russia. But I need to say that for most of them, for those revolutionaries, America was an imagined country. Very few of them ever traveled to the United States. And what they knew about the United States was mostly books they read, or they started to read Alexis Tocqueville on democracy in America since the period in the 1830s. But they never traveled. And so America became a kind of utopia, a country which could be ascribed the features they wanted to see in Russia. That's why for Russian anarchists, description of America was a kind of anarchical society. You know, they described America as a country without strong central government, and with a low important communities, and you know, according to anarchist model. So for them, the United States was an anarchist country. For those who want to establish a technocratic society, America was described as a country which is ruled by engineers and planned, even, you know, who planned the future for the society, and they ascribed their ideal to the description of America. So they, every group, ideological group within Russia who criticized Russian society, Russian existing order, they ascribed to their vision of America something they wanted to see in their own country. And that is a revolutionary ideal for the United States. And the next idea about the United States began to be formed in 1830s, especially 1840s, and that was a country of technological miracles, the hotbed of industry, the country which Russia could rely in its technological advances. Nicholas I, Russian Tsar Nicholas I, was probably the first Tsar in the 19th century who understood that Russia is lagging behind of its arch rival, Great Britain, in terms of technological advance. Britain began to build railroads, to build steamships for the navy, and Russia was lacking these technologies. And that's why several expeditions, several engineers, groups of engineers traveled through Europe and America to bring back the idea where the Russia could borrow these new technologies, and the final decision was to borrow those technologies from the United States. The United States were friendly, at least not had nothing to share with, nothing to contend with Russia, and was ready to sell the technologies for Russia. And unlike the Great Britain, which was already the foe or the rival. So in the 1840s, Nicholas I invited several, maybe about 100 people, maybe more than 100 people, the best engineers from the United States, that helped them to build the first big railroad between Moscow and St. Petersburg. That then helped to build the first telegraph lines in Russia, who helped to establish the steamship navigation on Russian rivers and in the sea-going steamers. So that was a turn to America for a source of the expertise. What is interesting, for Americans, that was the first such a big attention they got from the European country. You know, by that time, Russia was a great power, and the United States in the 1840s were still like secondary country was less important, and which we did not participate in European balance of power. And then they saw that one of those big, great European countries went to America to brought its expertise. And that was actually helped to Americans to rethinking about its own identity. If you read the newspapers of the late 40s, or even textbooks of American textbooks of the late 1840s, you will see that Americans paid a lot of attention that Russia did invite American engineers, and that helped them begin to think about, Americans begin to think about themselves as a nation of engineers, a nation of inventors in the nation. And that helped them to change, to correct, to amend their own identity. And for Russia it wasn't important also because since Nicholas I, every Russian ruler, again, Russian Tsar or General Secretary of Communist Party or President, every ruler at the time when he wanted to make a breakthrough in the economic life, to achieve the better economic condition in Russia, each of them turned to America as a source of that expertise. Nicholas I, it then happened with Alexander II, it happened in the early years of Nicholas II. It was during Bolshevik rule. In 1920, at the time when the United States did not diplomatically recognize Russia, the Soviet Russia, the Soviet Russia did invited a lot of Americans to help help achieve industrialization aims. And you know, around 1930, about 500 new enterprises, new factories, plants were built in Russia on the American projects and American industrialization. You know, when I was a schoolboy in the Soviet Union, we did not speak about American participation in all of that, but we did study the great construction site of the first five-year plan that included Magnitogorsk metallurgical combine, Dnipro-Gas hydroelectric station, Stalingrad tractor plant, Nizhny Novgorod automobile plant. All of them, all of these big buildings were built by Americans or by Russians on the American, on American design. And that was an important, and since that, after Bolsheviks, you know, each ruler, when Khrushchev wanted to make a breakthrough, he traveled to America. When Gorbachev announced this uskorenie, or you know, how to translate uskorenie, announced his aim to accelerate the economic development in Russia, he also reestablished the better relations with the United States. So the United States was looked as a model and as a source of innovations. During Bolsheviks, by the way, it was, you know, that was a famous slogans that socialism is a Soviet power plus, well, Russians probably will say plus electrification, but there is also a different slogan at that time. Socialism is a Soviet power plus Americanization, or a Fordization of industry. Fordization from Henry Ford, meaning that high efficiency of economy. By the way, Trotsky, who was a big fan of American economy at that time, and Trotsky in the 20s was still one of the first leaders between Lenin and Stalin. And Trotsky even wrote that there are two countries which are close to socialism. Russia, because Russia had the Soviet power and they just needed to achieve economic efficiency like it is in the United States, and the United States, because it's already reached this efficiency, and they just needed the Soviet power. And that's, Europe is far behind because they have neither efficiency of Americans or Soviet power of Russians. So that was an interesting twist of the attitudes to the United States. So Gorbachev and even Dmitry Medvedev, who used to be president, if you remember, for 4 years, several years ago, Dmitry Medvedev, he used the word modernization as his campaign slogan, and first he did, after that he traveled to Silicon Valley, he brought back iPhones and all of that. So every of the Russian ruler who wanted to achieve economic breakthrough look onto America as a model. But this is a cyclic thing. At the point when this ruler, probably the same or the next one, changed his agenda, and instead of trying to get a breakthrough in economy, tried to keep the power or to keep the free, to make a society free, frozen, and that eventually happens with most of them because they lived for a long time with power. At that point, the United States became the threat, because it became the threatening power which is used by revolutionaries or reformists from behind, who were trying to undermine the power of those people in power. So it was in the late years of Nicholas I, in the late years of Nicholas II, it was in the late years of Stalin. So each time when the agenda of the Russian rulers was, you know, switched to keeping the power, the United States became threat much more than the source of the innovation. Let's turn a bit for American beyond Russia. I don't know if anybody here attended my yesterday talk, evening talk. I will repeat some of the ideas I said. The first American debate about Russia took place in 1813. And what happened in 1813? Those of you who remember American history probably do remember that was a year of, do you remember what was it? The year of the War of 1812. The war started in 1812, war against England, and it continued until early 1815. So 1813, the war in the middle was in the middle. The Boston merchants, the people in Boston, and partially New York City, who had all of this economy dependent on the of the sea trade, seagoing vessels, suffered a lot because British Navy, of course, controlled all the Atlantic, and this economy of Boston merchants and Boston fisheries, Boston, you know, everything in Boston was connected to sea, was suffering a lot. So they were against the war. But during the war, to protest against the war is unpatriotic, at least. And so they, but those people, and especially Federalist Party, which was a major political representation, Federalist Party, decided to express their dissatisfaction with President Madison's conduct of the foreign affairs. And what they did? They organized a series of events to celebrate the victories of Russian arms. Because Russia, in the same year, had its own war of 1812. It was a war against Napoleon. Napoleon invited Russia, And Russian by the early 1813 get Napoleon out of Russia and started to chase his army till Russia entered Paris. So to celebrate, technically, Russia was on the other side, because Russians' war against Napoleon was on the, Russia was on the British side. They fought against Napoleon together with England. So technically, it was on different side. But Russian-American relations were just recently established in 1807, and that was still in a good shape, with nothing probably to discuss a lot, but it was a good shape. And they decided, Federalists and Boston Federalists decided to celebrate. It was at least two big dinners organized, one in Boston and the second in Georgetown, in Washington, in fact, with about 500 people attended each of them, the top part of the elite, oppositional elite in the United States, and they toasted Russian Tsar, Russian victories, Russian soldiers, and all of that stuff. Immediately, when these plans were announced, and after the dinners took place, those media and those politicians who supported President Madison began to criticize the very idea to celebrate Russian victories. And they, of course, they understood that it is a challenge to the official foreign policy. So they tried to criticize the very idea to celebrate. And the ways they celebrate, how could you celebrate Russian victories? Because Russia is an uncivilized, barbaric country. Any Russian is a Cossack, and any Cossack is man-eater, is one of the lines of newspapers. How you can celebrate the Russian victories over Napoleon? Because it was the Russian frost that killed most of the French soldiers. And to celebrate Russian victories is the same as to celebrate yellow fever in the Central America, which kills people, And all of that line of arguments. And of course, those who organized the dinner responded. And their media, their newspapers, and their politicians started to say, no, Russia is the most rapidly advanced country in Europe. Russia was used to be barbaric, but by now Russia is developing very rapidly. Moreover, Russia is the most liberal country in contemporary Europe, and Russian Tsar now is liberating Europe from the tyranny of Napoleon. And Alexander the First, Russian Tsar himself, is the most liberal-minded monarch in all Europe. So it was a different type of arguing. And so the whole 1813, American newspapers, American politicians were engaged in this battle about the merits, contemporary merits of Russia. For neither side, Russia itself meant anything important. It was just a tool, or I would say, battlefield around the President Madison's foreign relations. But Russia was used actively by both sides. So that was the first ever debate about Russia in American society, American political society. Since that, Russia turned to the better position, especially by the middle of the 18th century. Well, Russia did help Americans several times. The first assistance Americans received during the War for Independence, Catherine the Great in 1780 announced the armed neutrality, that meaning that Russia promised to defend with the Russian Navy the right of neutral trade with American colonies, with the colonies which was actually the challenge to British attempts to blockade the colonies, and that actually helped American colonies a lot. Later in the 40s, I already mentioned that it was a time when Russian government invited many Americans, and that actually pleased American society very much. And Americans started to think about Russia in the better terms and discussed Russia in better terms. Okay, they cherish our expertise, probably they're good people. That was, again, the way of. So by the early 50s of the 19th century, American attitude to Russia became very positive. And when Russia got the war, Crimean War of 1853-1856. It was a war with Russia held against Turkey, Ottoman Empire, Britain, France, and Italy, Savoy Kingdom at the time. and Russia lose that war. But Americans were very sympathetic to Russia, to Russian side, and not only sympathetic. About 50 American surgeons traveled to Crimea and served in the Russian hospitals, military hospitals during the war, to help Russians to survive the ones. And that was a story how American society had attitude towards the event. During the American Civil War, Russia was the only European country that assisted the North, the federal government, without any attempt to play on the split like Britain and France did at that time. Russia, in 1863, Russia did send a navy, actually a squadron, New York City, to New York Harbor, and then to Potomac near Washington. And of course, that expedition of Russian Navy had at least two reasons. One of the reasons was to support support Lincoln and to express its political support to the federal cause. And the second was very strategic and was based on the very different consideration, because it was in the year 1863 when Poland, that was a part of Russian Empire at that time, Poland uprised. It was a Polish rebellion, which Russia did suppress. And at that point, Britain and France did criticize very much Russian aggression of the Poles. And you know, there is a cartoon somewhere, of the British cartoon of that time. Actually, cartoon was devoted to this Russian Navy visit of America. It was Lincoln and Alexander II shaking hands to each other. And they have like blood on their hands, both of them, and suppressed Polish behind the Russian Tsar and suppressed Southerners behind Lincoln. Those, you know, two bloody tyrants were shaking hands. It was British view in 1863. But if you look on the Russian side, of course, they were afraid of the possibility of a new war against Britain. It was, you know, Crimean War just ended 6-7 years ago. So they were afraid. And one of the major lessons of the Crimean War was that the biggest and the most modern Russian Navy did not participate in the Crimean War because it was situated in Baltic Sea. And the Baltic Sea is like a bottle. You cannot enter to Britain, because Britain just can put one ship on the very narrow strait between Denmark and Sweden, and that's it. So the fleet cannot pass. That's why the Russian general staff or admiralty decided to send the fleet to the high sea. In case of the war against Great Britain, this fleet can be used against Britain, you know, on the high sea. So that was a strategic point. Of course, Lincoln and Americans who followed these international events understood both ideas, that strategic purpose of Russia, of Russian general staff, but they wanted to use it, of course, politically inside the United States, and saying that there was a rumor event, then Russian admiral who headed this expedition had like zealot order to enter the war on the Lincoln side or federal side, and that actually helped propagandistically. It helped Lincoln very much. Which is interesting about that story, it still exists it reappears every time when Russian-American relations made some turn. And at the time when Russian-American relations became better, and it was several times, during the Second World War, during Gorbachev, every time somebody among American politicians or American journalists rediscovers that history of the Russian fleet visit of 1863 and says, you know, we always were friends. And that was a story how Russians did support Lincoln, how they were friendly to us. But every time the cycle made it's another turn and Russian-American relations deteriorate, somebody will found it, say, you know, I did not just rediscover it. The Russians sent the fleet not because they wanted to support Lincoln, but because they wanted to have this, you know, to solve the strategic problem of of its fleet, and they just wanted to get into the high sea. And that's not because they wanted to support us, they never was friendly. And that was an interesting how the same cycles repeat again and again. It was like three or four cycles already. They have post explanations for that region. So by the end of the 19th century, the American vision of Russia began to deteriorate. And I would say that was a period of the big crisis of American identity. You know, that's, again, those of you who remember American history, the period immediately after the end of the Reconstruction, the South, like late 70s and the 80s of the 19th century. It was a period when Americans got disappointed very much in the results of Reconstruction, of the Civil War, because after many hundreds of thousands killed in the Civil War, after almost two decades of Reconstruction, the new Jim Crow laws were re-established in the South. The same white aristocracy get back to power in the South. And so for what, and what was the result of all of these sufferings and all of the sacrifice? And besides all of that, President Grant administration was widely believed to be very corrupt. And so this vision of American society was pretty gloomy at that point. So that was from, again, getting back from this constructivist methodology, that was a time when politicians, American politicians, American journalists needed to find a way to, to reestablish American trust, to American confidence in itself. And so that was a, it was a time when American politicians, American readings, part of American society that read and tried to formulate the new ideals, were looking for something to that can, could help themselves to think about themselves on the better terms. And it coincided that George Kennan the Elder, we have two George Kennan in our history of Russian-American relations, George Kennan the Elder, the traveler who visited Siberia for the second time already, published his book about the Siberian exile. You know, before that, more than 10 years before, he published a very sympathetic book about Siberian people. He traveled through Siberia for the first time in the 1860s, and that was very sympathetic. So when he decided to go to Siberia for the second time, he got a permission from the Russian state, and he traveled in the middle of the 1880s, again through Siberia. He got all the permission from the Russian state to meet anybody he wanted. But in the middle of the 1880s was the time of the Russian reaction. In 1881, Russian revolutionaries assassinated Tsar Alexander II. After that, it was the start of the reaction on the repression. The new Tsar Alexander III sent to Siberia to the forced work or just to exile all the revolutionaries, people's will, народная воля. Many liberals, many critics of the regime, even those who were not revolutionary but themselves, but were critical. Yeah. That was a time when most of those independently thinking people were sent to Siberia. And Kennan, who traveled to Siberia, met all of them. And he heard all of this, their explanation of the Russian Russian situation. And he, when he returned, he said that the Russia is a country where the best people are sent to exile to Siberia. And he, moreover, Kennan started a kind of a crusade. He spent the next 10 years lecturing through all the United States. Some of his biographies counted that during the 10 years, he almost every day he had some lecture about the Russian Siberia as an exile. He got, you know, he went to the podium with chains on his legs, you know, saying in the uniform of the Russian forced laborer in Siberia, and said about this Russian cruel Russian government that sent best people to Siberia. You know, some biographer counted that he addressed for about 1 million people through the 10 years series of lectures in America. So he's probably the most his influence was the most important in these changes of American mind about what Russia was. And what is interesting, he introduced this idea of Russia, of Siberia, at least as a big, big prison in Russia. What was interesting, when Americans, like century after Josh Kennan first read Solzhenitsyn, Gulag Archipelago, they recognized very well this idea. We already knew that Russia is a big prison. And what is interesting that for Solzhenitsyn himself, it was a wrong comparison, because for Solzhenitsyn, Tsar's Russia was much better than the Soviet Gulag, and he did not want this comparison. But American attitude, well, it's just a reinforcement of what they already knew from Kennan's book. You know, so Archipelago, Gulag was just a, you know, repetition of what they knew about Russia. And that is one of the ideas. So by the end of the 19th century, the three different attitudes toward Russia emerged in American society, and one of them was a, okay, like I would say, purely Russophobic. You cannot, those who are very critical to everything Russian, they say that Russia is a lagging behind, autocratic country, that Russian people and Russian government like each other, and they do not want democracy at all. So we just need to, they did not use a containment term, world containment, but it's something like that. There is also another attitude also developed approximately at that time, and those people were people who studied and translated Russian culture. Those people who translated Turgenev, Tolstoy, Dostoevsky, Chekhov into English and brought their books to America. Those who brought Russian musicians like Tchaikovsky to America. Those who described Russia as a country with a beautiful culture. And their position was, why you criticize, why you pay attention to Russian political system? Let's see on the Russian culture. The political system is something we just do not, which is not matter for us, doesn't matter anything for us. So they actually was the same type of people as those who described to Americans China. But, you know, those who describe only culture without trying to address political system. But in unlike China, in America, those who described Russia only from cultural point of view were in the minority. And the third group called themselves the Friends of Russian Freedom. That was a Society of American Friends of Russian Freedom, formed approximately the 1880s. They actually invited Josh Kennan to be its president. Kennan declined, but their attitude was very close to his. The idea was that there is a very good, freedom-loving Russian people and a very oppressive Russian government. And we should help Russian people to get rid of Russian government somehow. What is interesting, among those who organized and who formed this American Society of Russian Freedom, we were some of the children and even some of the older people, members of the abolitionist movement. Those who were abolitionists or who raised up in the families of abolitionists. And they used the same language that abolitionists used when described the South before the Civil War. They used in describing Russia. As the same way that abolitionists say that there is black people in the South who needed our help to get rid of the oppressive slaveholders, they described Russia, that Russian good people that needed to get rid of the oppressive government, and they used exactly the same line of argument. So that was the third line. When I see contemporary argument about Russia in the United States, I see all of the three trends are still here, still among the discussion. So, let's jump ahead, because in the 20th century, the new vision of the American vision of Russia was appeared after the Russian Revolution of 1917. It suddenly became clear that Soviet Russia offers some a different ideal to the rest of the mankind. Well, this communist Bolshevik ideas. And the first reaction in the United States was a big Red Scare. In 1918, 1819, here in the United States, it was a big scare that all the labor unrest was attributed to the Soviet or Russian influence, Russian interference. And all of the rest of the everything that Americans did not like was also attributed to the influence of Bolsheviks. Most of the 20th century went with this idea that Russia is a kind of existential threat. Not only because it's actually formed before the nuclear power, before the Second World War. It first formed in the late second decade of the 20th century. And that was because the Americans did not. There is one interesting comparative story. About conspiracy theories. There is two documents, one in Russia and one in the United States. In Russia, there's a document called, in Russian, they call it Plan of Alan Dulles, the former head of CIA. And that's a document, it's actually a fake document, but it's pretty widespread among Russians, especially Russians, Russian conservative part of Russia. And this is a document which describes how Americans should help Russia to collapse. And to help Russia to collapse, they needed to encourage, a lot of things, including the freedom thinking, the free love, like everything that conservatives did not like. But you can just imagine, the whole list of this, all of that was introduced into Russia by CIA from this point of view. And there is another document which was spread here in the United States. They call the Communist Rules of the Revolution. It was also pretty widespread, maybe less widespread than Plan of Dulles in Russia, but still it was even introduced to Congress several times. You can find it in the congressional hearings. Until the New York Times in 1970 discovered that it was a fake. And that was actually the same type of idea. That was everything, that listed everything that American conservatives did not like and said this is something that Bolsheviks and Russians wants to introduce into our society. The difference between Russian and American version was probably one. American version also included the ban on the weapons, ban on the arms trade. And that was also part of this image. Russians wanted Americans to ban free sell of arms. So that's how each country uses each other for the sake of solving the home problems. So in the 20th century, this new view of each other as a foe emerged. First of all, because two countries represented two poles, ideological poles, and also because two countries, especially since the Second World War, represented the two poles of power in the country. So that there are new books recently published, which actually describes the Cold War as a time which two countries needed to portray themselves as, from the better point of view. That the country, let's say, put it differently. The book, this new cultural histories of the second of the Cold War, describes the Cold War as something which pushed both countries into internal domestic reforms. And they say that Americans needed to push for civil rights movement and to civil rights equality because of the Cold War, because Americans needed to demonstrate that America is better than the Soviet Union. And also the Soviet Union needed to push for some reforms because it needed to win a competition over the United States. And at some point, like in the late 70s, this domestic concerns was much more concern was much more important than international concern. You probably some of you do remember that the early 1970s was a time of the détente. This time when President Nixon and General Secretary Brezhnev meet each other, signed a lot of agreements about the arms control, and then it suddenly stopped in the second half of the 70s. When Jimmy Carter became American president, it stopped. Sometimes it's explained by the Brezhnev or Soviet Union did invited Afghanistan, but it happened only in December of 1979. By that time, the détente was already dead for 4 years. What happened? One of the explanations, maybe not the only one, but one of the explanations, and we know that Carter's national security advisor, Zbigniew Brzezinski, clearly, explicitly advised him like that, was that Carter's main goal, main aim, was to reestablish American confidence, because the first half of the 70s ended with a big disaster, with the economic crisis, when, you know, organizations, Arabic countries which exported oil, raised its four times overnight, raised the price four times overnight, and American economy suffered a lot. American military was defeated in Vietnam, finally, and American political system was defeated by Watergate. So the three pillars, three sources of American pride collapsed within several months, within very short period of time. So Carter, and after him, Reagan, wanted to make America great again. So Carter, actually, Reagan used that slogan. So Carter wanted to do it. That was much more important for him than the relations with the USSR. And just imagine yourself to be Carter, to be Jimmy Carter in the late 70s. Look around, what you can use to be, you know, to demonstrate that your country is better than the Soviet Union. What was the result, what was the achievement of your society? And the major achievement in the middle of the 70s was the victory of the civil rights movement. You know, the previous two previous decades, since late 50s to early 70s, it was a time of, you know, of big battles for racial equality in the south of the United States. And by the middle of the 70s, it was a very significant achievement that you know, civil rights legislation went through, and there was no more segregation in the South. So what Carter did, he just projected this agenda of civil rights into relations with the USSR. And he started to criticize Soviet Union for violation of human rights. Of course, Carter himself was a true believer in that. And of course, there was a violation of human rights in the Soviet Union. Of course, these dissident people who fought, heroically fought actually against the Soviet power, got a big help from the Americans at that point of view, at that period. So it was sincere, it was true. But at the same time, for Carter, it was also a political decision which he used to reestablish American confidence. So he sacrificed Brezhnev, Nixon achievement in the international relations to achieve domestic goals in the United States. So that was, and just a few words at the end before I get to the Q&A session. It's about immigration. This is a very important part of our relations. You know, there was a huge number of Russians who immigrated to the United States. Okay, Russian Jews, first of all, but also Russians, ethnic Russians, but also religious group, Russian Germans. In the late 90s, early 20th century, about 2 million or some say up to 3 million people immigrated from Russia to the United States. And among those who immigrated were people who, or children of whom, did created or did influence the American culture of the 20th century to a large extent, to a very, very big extent. And you know that people like Irving Berlin, who was born in Tumen, Russia, you know Irving Berlin, probably the composer of the number of favorite American songs. People who founded at least three big major Hollywood studios. Which one? Metro Goldwyn Mayer, Warner Brothers. All of them were born in Russian Empire. Those people immigrated there. So they influenced culture and so much that when, after the death of Stalin, the Soviet Union and the United States decided to reestablish cultural exchanges. The main producer of those exchanges, impresario Saul Yurok, also who was also born in the Russian Empire, joked several times, you know, just repeatedly, he liked the joke probably, joked that, do you know what does it mean, Russian, Soviet-American cultural exchange? It means that they brought to us the Jews from Odessa of their own, and I sent to Russia Jews from Odessa from here, from the United States. So yeah, они привозят своих евреев из Одессы, я посылаю своих евреев из Одессы. So it was, and so the cultural influence of people born in the Russian Empire, for the Russian Empire, was pretty big here in the United States. But not only culture. You probably know Sikorsky. You know, Sikorsky was a prominent Russian engineer before the revolution, and he immigrated, and all the Sikorsky copters was created already here. You, probably some of you know Zvarykin, who was the pioneer of television, or Punyatov, who invented the video recording device. So it was many engineers, up to Sergey Brin, one of the co-inventor of Google. But also there was a political, which is maybe less known, but there was political influence, ideological influence of the United States. And this is interesting because those people who escaped from Russia wanted to build America as the opposite to the country they escaped from. And depending on the period when they escaped, they worked here in the United States in a different direction. Just a brief story about two women, two Jewish Jewish Russian becoming American women, born both in Petrograd and Petersburg, in St. Petersburg, but in the different generations. First one emigrated from Russia in 1882, just in the beginning of this reaction, which I already mentioned, you know, after the assassination of Alexander II. And she emigrated as a 7-year-old girl to New York City and then to other American parts of America. Her name was Emma Goldman. And she started to hate the big state back in Russia. And she continued to hate the state here in the United States. She became the prominent anarchist, one of the leading figures in the American anarchist movement. She became very popular, and she was you know, very influential here as a left-wing ideologue. Moreover, later, like almost a century later, in 1960s, during the rise of the civil rights movement and feminist movement, the American feminists used the slogans from Emma Goldman, and they used her as one of the precursor of feminist ideas. So she is, like I would say, very important ideologue of American left, Emma Goldman. And the second Jewish American girl from Petersburg emigrated from Petersburg in 1927. It was in the first decade of the Soviet power, of the radical experiment in Russia, which was held by Bolsheviks. She emigrated from the leftist experiment, and she became very prominent right-wing ideologue here in the United States. Her name was Alice Rosenbaum, but you probably know, some of you probably know her by her pen name, Ayn Rand. Ayn Rand was very influential. You know, people like Alan Greenspan, who used to be the head of the American financial system. Reserve for America. And Greenspan once told that it was Ayn Rand who taught him that capitalism is not only economically more efficient than socialism, but also better from the ethic, moral point of view. It has a higher moral, and that was something that Ayn Rand wanted to introduce. So she also continued her crusade, her fight against this leftist memories of her childhood and her early stage. So that is how immigration influenced the United States. If they continue to try to make America the country which is opposite to what they have in the past. Not only the prominent ideologists do this way. If you compare the different waves of Russian immigrants who lives here in the United States, you will see that those who immigrated from the Soviet Union, like back in the 70s, and okay, the big group of Russian immigrants around New York City, they mostly now vote Republican, and they're pretty right-wing, and they criticize American Democrats for trying to make America socialist. And you know, they say, okay, all of these people like Obama are trying to make America kind of USSR, and we against that. Those people vote the Republican usually. But those who immigrated from Russia later, like in the last two decades, under Putin, for instance, I can guess, there is no raw data, but as far as I see, many of them would probably vote Democrat and not Republican. They escaped from the right-wing Russia which is much less, especially now, from the so-called traditional values Russia. And those people here in America doesn't want America to be this type of right wing. They do not like Trump because Trump resembles Putin, and they do not want him. And this is a difference. So different immigrants continue their, you know, to fight here in the United States. The fight started before them. Well, that's almost an end. Americans actually, by the way, also immigrated to Russia. Not in such a big numbers, not millions, maybe hundreds of people through all of that. But there was an important immigration. In the late 19th, early 20th century, we know at least several names of African Americans who immigrated from racist America to get to prominence in Russia. At least two of them, you know, one, James Wingfield, who used to be he was a jockey, who was horse races in Kentucky, and he was banned from participation after he won first race. And he immigrated to Russia and became very prominent and rich person there, James Wingfield. Frederick Thomas started here as a bellboy in the hotel, and he traveled to Russia and he got a fortune there. And he became the owner of the two most popular restaurants in Moscow by the time of revolution. One, Yar, which was the most popular among Russian merchants, and another, Maxim, which is the most popular among Russian aristocracy. So he was an owner of two of them. And he was, both of them were African Americans who probably would not achieve such a prominence here in the United States at that time. And after the revolution, it's continued because there was groups of African Americans who traveled to the Soviet Union because Soviet Union was considered to be colorblind society. It was not true. They complained about racism in Soviet Union, but it was a different type of racism. It was not political, it was xenophobic, I would say, more of that. But some of them also achieved some prominence, and it's an interesting story how there's a lot of stories about that. One of the stories about Robert Robinson, African-American skilled worker who traveled to Russia during industrialization. And he was the only African-American among the group of Americans in Stalingrad during construction of Stalingrad plant. So his fellow Americans beat him because he was black, and some of them were racist. And it actually led to the big trial. The Soviet court convicted those American whites who beat this Robert Robinson. They were expelled from the Soviet Union. And Robert Robinson, when he tried to get back to America, faced here a big hatred because he got a prominence. Time magazine published that story, and everybody knew that he was a tool of Soviet propaganda. So he returned to Russia in the late 30s, and he became elected the member of Moscow City Council, City Soviet. And he stayed in Russia for almost his life till the early 70s. He tried to escape Russia after the Second World War, but he was not permitted to go. He tried several times. He addressed Paul Robeson, the famous African American singer who was befriended Soviet government. But Paul Robeson refused to help him. He answered, "You know, I will help you to escape, and you will say something bad about Soviet Union, and my friends will be upset." So it was a response of Paul Robeson. But finally, he got permission. Already in the advanced age, after 40 years in the 70s, he got permission to travel to his friend, a former ambassador from Uganda, to Africa, and that. He got to Uganda, immediately appeared in American embassy, reestablished his American citizenship, and finally he published a book very critical to the Soviet regime, Black on Red, the title was Black on Red. So, but that was a story of initial achievement and later disappointment about the Soviet. And okay, and to end with a contemporary event. I know that maybe some of you will be interested to listen. I do not know about anything that you do not know about Russian meddling, Russian hackers, or Russian interference into American elections. So I have nothing to say. Maybe it happened, maybe it happened. But as a constructivist, I see how American media and American politicians uses this pretext. And from my point of view, what we saw in the last 2 years was an overblowing of that story, just because the Americans get into new crisis of American identity. You know, with an election of Trump, Americans again were hard to answer the question, what you are. You know, before that, it was quite easy to say who Americans, what Americans were. And after, you know, but many Americans who were ready to associate themselves with people like Barack Obama or even Hillary Clinton could never be associate themselves with Trump. Okay, we are like Trump? No, it cannot be like that. So Trump was, and that was an easy thing to associate Trump with foreign power. And that actually was used many times in the previous era and by both countries. In 2011, 2012, when Russian opposition went to the street to protest against rigged elections of 2011, that was the last big protest against Putin regime in Russia, Putin propaganda did exactly the same. It said that all those who protested against Putin were American agent or American pawns, and they do it because they want to help the enemy power of the United States. And propaganda needed first, they needed two things. First, to connect somehow, at least in the perception of majority, to connect oppositioners to the United States. And the second, they needed to demonize the United States. Because it's not enough to connect people with America, if America is friendly. You need to make America look like threatening and the country which the only has the only aim to destroy Russian, destroy Russia, Russian state, Russian country, Russian identity. So they did it to marginalize opposition. And then after 2016, I see how people who dislike election of President Trump use actually the same political tactic. You need to connect Trump somehow with Russia and to portray Russia in the worst possible way. I do not want to defend Putin and Putin's regime. I don't like what Putin did to Ukraine. I do not like what Putin does to home freedoms. But when I read American explanation of all of that, I want to defend Russia, saying that Russia is not as bad as American media now portray itself. Because I see that here is a political reason for demonizing and, you know, using only black color in picture in Russia. Because it's a story about the internal home American domestic clash between those who do not like President Trump and those who. And again, Russia is just a tool of fighting against Trump. But it's unfortunate because this type of propaganda will have its consequences. And we will have this image of evil Russia, which will exist long after both Trump and Putin will be history. Okay, I will stop here. Thank you for your attention. And that is ready to answer.
Thank you so much for that really rich and enlightening talk. I'm sure we have lots of questions from the audience, and we do have about 15 minutes, maybe 20, to take your questions. So please.
Thank you very much for the very interesting talk. And I would like to ask you more about the methodology of your research, because when you speak, I understand constructivism, but when you speak about the perception of United States in Russia and Russia in United States, what sources do you use mainly, and how do you deal with the sources, how many of them? So if you could say more about the methodology, about this, you know, the mutual perception between those two states.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, I'm a historian, first of all, yeah. So my sources are mostly the political speeches, political publications in newspapers, and that's and also textbooks when you speak about the 19th century. We, with my collaborator, Victoria Juravlova, you mentioned her name, she's more active in this type of sources. She uses the cartoons, political caricatures, which actually very good. When you see the cartoons, how you describe how the painters, how the caricaturists paint the other country or the other nation, it's very, very clear the message they want to deliver. So that's a lot of paper, a lot of paper sources of that. And you can analyze them. Well, if you speak about the 19th century, you can read almost most of the speeches and use it as a base for your conclusion. If you speak about the 20th century, you of course you need some content analysis, and that's because there's a number of words is much bigger. But yes, mostly it's an analysis of political speeches, newspapers, other media, and textbooks. Because in textbooks, you know, school textbooks, when you describe the other country, it's like a very short collection of stereotypes about the other country. And this is stereotypical. It's something that everybody knew about the other country. And if you read it from the vintage point of a different, of being a citizen of a different country, it sometimes looks very strange. We did, you know, like 10 years ago, we made a collection of it was partially in Russian, partially in English, published in Russia, about textbooks, that Russia and the United States in textbooks of each other. That was a good, interesting collection from my point of view. We used history textbooks, geography textbooks, political science, and it looks very interesting how two countries portray each other. And this is a good source, I think, for getting to perceptions. That's, I hope I answered. Yeah.
So you have mentioned the United States being sort of a role model for Russia for, I guess, over two centuries, both in the technological sense and political sense. But of course, if you look at the last 20 years, the Western Europe, specifically the European Union, and the People's Republic of China are also sometimes viewed as models in various ways. Like some people, of course, would say that maybe the European democracy is something which fits us better than American, and some people would say that maybe it's the Chinese way of building the transportation networks or setting up an internet infrastructure is something which suits us better. So do you feel that Russia, in a sense, sometimes orients more toward the United States, sometimes more toward China, sometimes toward Russia, and how this reorientation happens based on which factors? Or you cannot really say that.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I'll start with no. Russia's continued to see the on the United States much more than on the China or Europe. If you read contemporary political speeches, it's still America everywhere. If you know, Russian deputies of the State Duma wanted to introduce some new legislation on whatever topic, they will say that they have this legislation in the United States, and they will never mention China or. It's something China, Russia, still, America still continue to be this constitutive other, and this is important. Putin always say that when he decide anything on the foreign relations, he said, Americans did it. American did it in Kosovo, so we did it here in Abkhazia or something. So America, never China, or never Europe. Europe considered to be like, not sovereign, I've said, not free, not escape. But you would say there is an interesting story. Yeah, when I was talking about this image of America as, you know, as imagined country, I did not mention the situation in the 1990s. You know, it was a time when America came as a real country to Russia. Before that, you can imagine America. You can ascribe to America whatever you think important and interesting, but. In 1990s, America, the United States, came to Russia as a power, as a country, with business, and with advisors to Yeltsin's government. And it was a time of, for many, it was a time of disappointment, because America did not look like the utopian model they have in their heads. Those people who praised the United States during the closed Soviet Union time were disappointed because they saw that America is different. America is free, but not as free as we saw. You know, it was actually, by the way, it was even my opinion when I first came to the United States in 1990, and saw that America is free, but not in the same, not that way free as I thought about America. You know, because, well, to some, in some aspects, Soviet Union in 1990 was more free than the United States. Not in political sense, of course, not in political. In terms of liberty and the political freedoms, the United States were always ahead of Russia. But in some other aspects, freedom are, well, Russia, the United States was still conservative, with much more limitations on the everyday behavior. Back in the 1990s, I was surprised to see that, you know, what type of swimming suit you can wear, which was, you know, not the case in the Soviet Union. But here, okay, if you go to some beach in some Midwestern city, well, you need to think what you wear. So that's stories about the freedoms. And people discovering this America were disappointed. And there was a kind of anti-Americanism of acquaintance. Actually, the Western Europe also experienced the same story, but a generation earlier, when America came to Western Europe after the Second World War, back in the 50s, I would say, late 40s and 50s. And that was a time when Europeans, especially French, but not only French, developed its anti-Americanism. There was no such a thing as anti-Americanism before the Second World War. But it appeared when America came to Europe, came to Europe, Western Europe in the 50s, to Eastern Europe in the 90s, and to Russia in the 90s. And that was a change of the mind. Not universal. Of course, many people continue to be very pro-American in Russia. And still there are people like Westerners in Russia who like American way of life. But it's much less. There is much more people who are now anti-American because of disappointment in the United States. And about China, well, there are some politicians who speak about China, but it doesn't seem sincere, and people are pretty much afraid about Chinese way of life. I cannot say that it's to any extent popular. Well, there is. To be sincere, I knew economists who said that Chinese model is much better than Russian one, that Chinese did the right thing, that it was, well, I know such people. But I cannot say this is widespread. I cannot say that people wanted to live in China. I do not say that any group of Russians will answer they would like to live in China, no. And that's something. But we will find people who want to live in America or like in America. And as for Europe, well, there are more interests, of course, to Europe, but Europe does not consider it to be a model. Europe is a convenient place, a cozy place to live, but this is not a model, somehow. Which is maybe it's unjust to Europe, but I'm trying to explain the Russian attitude.
I wonder if you could say something a little bit more about the global context for these representations. You did a good job of showing Russian attitudes to America, the representations and kind of constructs, rhetorical constructs of the United States, of Russia. But a lot of the time, it seems to me, these kinds of constructs have another audience. And that is, you mentioned, for instance, the effects of the Cold War on the civil rights movement in the United States. Well, that audience was the developing world in many of those cases, the criticisms of civil rights in the United States by the Soviets and the criticisms of human rights in the US of the Soviets was directed towards our influence, neutral influence in the rest of the world. And so I'm wondering about that global context for many of these representations and whether you would have some additional things to add about that context.
Yeah, thank you. This is an important part that well, I would still insist that the major audience was inside the country. The major audience was a home constituency. But in order to attract home constituency, you should be attractive to the rest of the mankind. And that was because the United States, for all of its history, and Russia, at least for the time of the Soviet Union existence, we were trying to present themselves as a model for the rest of mankind. And that was important to have some proofs that the model works, that there are other people who wanted to join our movement. It was important in the Soviet Union, and later people start, now it's very popular to say, okay, Soviet Union spent billions of dollars, you know, billions of rubles at that time to help those obscure countries in Africa or somewhere, and the people did never return that money. And that. But it was important because it actually demonstrated to Russians and to Soviet people, demonstrated that there are people who believes in the Soviet example, Soviet model. And this was that was important. So I think, of course, that had some strategic vision. And of course, I do not want to sound that I just rule out all of the strategic political fight in the world, you know, for dominance. Of course, it did exist. But from my methodological point of view, from my vintage point of view, the domestic politics was way more important than the way, and politicians in the United States and even in the Soviet Union, maybe to some lesser extent, but still in the Soviet Union as well, and in Russia, of course, before and after the Soviet Union, the domestic concerns were primary, because